Ciao Alessandra.
Ciao, buongiorno e buon pomeriggio.
So, welcome back everybody. So, Atish cannot be here. I think he will join telematically later. Okay, welcome to the third lecture of Professor Alessandra Buonanno. And she's now going to talk about constraints on gravity and modified theory of gravity. So please, if you can share your slides. Great, I leave the floor to Alessandra for her third lecture. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. I'm very glad to be here again. So I wanted to have just a short connection with the previous lecture where I was showing you the slides that summarize the questions in physics and astrophysics that we are addressing with gravitational wave observations. And today I wanted to focus the lecture on how we can use the gravitational waves to probe gravity in the highly dynamical strong field regime. However, before doing that, I wanted to spend the first 10 minutes also telling you something that I couldn't cover last week, which is basically how we are, what are we learning about the formation scenario for the compact object binaries that we are observing. I mainly discussed on Thursday and Friday so-called exceptional events, but we have not discussed how we are seeing the entire population. So I wanted to actually spend just the first 10 minutes on that. So this is the outline of my presentation, of my lecture today. So as I said, I will first discuss some of the astrophysical properties of the binary system seen as a population. And then we are going to see the test, the theory agnostic test of general relativity, which the observation of LIGO and Virgo have enabled in the last few years. And in particular, the test of so-called gravitational wave generation, where the conservative and dissipative dynamics is intertwined, the test on the gravitational wave propagation, what can we say about the object that forms after merger and gravitational wave polarizations. We will see, not surprisingly, that so far, the binary neutron stars and neutron star black hole binaries that LIGO and Virgo have observed are consistent for the spiral stage with general relativity. And the same is true for binary black holes, including also the merger and the ring down. Now, through the lecture, I will also point out in a few occasions the fact that so far this test, at least from the point from the side of the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, have been done as theory agnostic tests. And so what are the prospects of theory specific tests of general relativity? And this we will see in a few times. Okay, so again, this is the overall the plot that describes the binary black holes. This is the mass in solar masses that have been observed by LIGO and Virgo. So you can see a variety in the distribution of masses of the black holes and also the neutron star that are here in orange, the binary neutron star and the neutron star black holes. Okay, so a few words about, again, if we look now at the overall distribution, what can we learn about it? So first, let me reintroduce the parameters on which the binary depends, the mass ratio, the total mass, the spin, so intrinsic rotation that the neutron star or the black hole carry, and there is a combination of the spin I was alluding last time on Friday that is best measured, which is the projection of the spin weighted by the masses along the direction perpendicular to the orbital plane. Now, when we put together the events, for example, the second catalog, which is not the latest one, the latest one is the third, but this is the first 6 months of the most recent run, which is called O3, the third run. So if you put together the posterior distributions, now I don't pretend that you can appreciate all the details here, but these are of the order, I think, of 24 sources. These are the so-called violin plots, the posterior distribution for the mass of the primary, the secondary, the mass ratio, the sky effective, and the distance. I just want to give you you can see immediately that there is a certain variety. The total masses of this binary are typically larger than the first catalog, which was covering the first two runs of LIGO and Virgo. Moreover, three, for example, binaries had a mass quite low, between 2.5 and 5 solar masses. Remember, the first detection of gravitational waves, the masses were 30, around 30 solar masses. And also, last week, I was pointing out that there has been one particular event with very large masses, in particular, the primary masses above the mass where we think a black hole from collapse of stars should not be there. And actually, the first 6 months of the run had overall three binaries with component masses larger than this value, which is the beginning of the gap, the so-called supernova mass gap, pair instability supernova mass gap. So it was not just an accident that we found that LIGO and Virgo found one event there. Moreover, people are also interested to understand whether the spin of the black holes or the neutron stars are different from zero. And at 90% credibility, 10 sources had this chi effective, this combination to be positive, which is possible if the spins, at least one of the spin of the two black holes is also positive. Another question we are interested is the projection of the spin on the orbital plane, because that will give us information about precession. If the spin are precessing, are not aligned with the orbital angular momentum, they will have, they produce some precessional cycles, and in principle, they could be measured. And so this parameter is denoted chi p, and here the posterior distribution is plotted for some events, contrasted with the prior, which is on the right. And you can see some mild sign of precession in the sense the posterior distribution is slightly different with respect to the prior. And last week, I was in particular telling you about this actually effect of the precession for the very large binary black hole, 190521. Okay, so now this was just the first 6 months of the last run. Now, if you add the second 6 months of the last run, which ends basically all the binary black holes of binary, compact binary observed by LIGO and Virgo, these are the new events. This is again the mass ratio, and this is the total mass. And I want to highlight just a couple of them. The 20th of February 2020, LIGO and Virgo measured, observed, another very high mass binary, which was very far from us, 6 gigaparsec. You can see here the total mass being around 200 solar masses. Another binary I want to highlight is this one, which had a mass ratio around 33. This is really quite an unusual event. In fact, the largest mass ratio that we have seen, which poses also some challenges from the point of view of the modeling. So that's quite interesting. And finally, I talked also about last week, we had the first neutron star black hole that was discovered, which is actually the posterior distribution is represented here. Now, an interesting quantity that astrophysicists are interested in is basically to compute the mass spectrum, for example, for the primary mass in the binary. And now what you can do with that is that you can actually try to use it to infer, maybe discriminate between population, different population of compact objects. I'm listed here the main channels to form binary systems. I don't have the time to go into the details. I just want to highlight a couple of them. The binary could be from what we say isolated binary channel could be coming from, which is basically binary, originally composed of stars that then go through supernova collapse and form black holes, so neutron stars. Another big main scenario is dynamical interactions in globular cluster, young stellar clusters, where the compact objects, black hole and neutron stars, could form the binary by dynamical capture. So they have not always been together, if you want, but they come so close to each other that they are captured in a bound orbit. And primordial black holes that do not come from the core collapse of stars, but a large fluctuation in the early universe. And people have been interested also to see if there are subpopulations in all these 90 binary systems that we have discovered, if there is a subpopulation of primordial black holes. Now, one way of discriminating between these scenarios is to look at quantities like the distribution of masses, but also the eccentricity, the spin magnitude, the spin precession, because, for example, you would expect precession if the two compact objects are dynamical, you form the binary through dynamical capture, because you can imagine the spins are originally randomly oriented, and then when the binary comes together, they, still have memory of, a generic direction of the spin in the in space. While with this scenario here, isolated binary channel, you generally tend to have spin which are aligned with the orbital angular momentum. The spin magnitude also can have an impact in the for primordial black holes, because we expect, at least in some scenarios, that the spin are basically negligible for primordial black hole population. Now, it is true that at the moment we are not able to extract in detail this information, so it is difficult to actually disentangle one scenario from the other. I think in the future, with many more events, this will be possible. Now, what I wanted to show you is that now if you take all the parameters that you have extracted, so you have all this population of tens of events, you do an inference study to and then you can try to fit this population for the mass of the primary. You can try to get to extract the spectrum of the binary black hole primary mass by fitting all the population with a function that, in first approximation, you may think this could be just a simple power law with an abrupt cutoff, because of supernova pair instability, you would expect that basically there is a cutoff with a mass larger than 50, 45, 50, 60 solar masses, that you don't see any more black holes, at least up to something like 120 solar masses. This is the results of the study done by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration. There are different models, I'm not going to describe them, but what came out is that actually there is a strong statistical preference for a mass distribution model, which is not a simple power law with an abrupt cutoff. And in fact, there are some features in the spectrum around 35 masses, solar masses, 18 and 10, which are not completely understood. Perhaps this one comes from the beginning of a possible mass gap, but the mass gap, as I said, is not an abrupt cutoff. The 10 solar masses here, well, there is a lack of binary black holes at mass in this range, so at some point you have a peak, and this could be explained with the population, the isolated binary population, for example, models. But the 18 solar mass peak here, for what I understand, is not really understood what's the reason. So I'm sure there will be many studies in the future about that. And the other important question you can ask is to look at the merger rate, for example, of binary black holes of this population as a function of the redshift, also that you can reconstruct. And this is plotted here at 90-95% credible level. And you see also here the star formation rate as a function of the redshift. And the merger rate follows, as expected, the star formation rate. We cannot say at the moment whether we can see a peak in the merger rate. The star formation generally has a peak around between, I think, 1.5 and 2 in redshift. Okay. Now, finally, considering all the binary black holes and the binary neutron stars, only two, but binary black holes in particular that we have discovered, but with the binary neutron star neutron star black hole, you can also estimate the so-called stochastic or a background of astrophysical background of these objects from the merger rate. And this is just the forecast taken again from a LIGO paper of the energy in the background, the astrophysical background due to these sources that you can see here. And when you take the total, you get basically this upper bound here. And I wanted just to highlight that this is the last run that was done. So in order to detect this background, astrophysical background, of made of all the binary, the signal from binary system that we cannot resolve individually, we will need to go to not even beyond O4. O4 will start, as I was saying last week, at the end of this year. O5 sometime in 2025, 2026, there might be the possibility of reaching this level here. Okay, so with that, I finish this first part, and now I want to dedicate the next 45 minutes to the test of general relativity that have been done in the last couple of years. So first of all, let me emphasize again that the regime that gravitational wave detectors are probing, it's different from the one that you can use to probe general relativity in the solar system with the experiment Gravity, which is looking at the galactic center, the Event Horizon Telescope, because in this case you are looking at a stationary black hole and an object that go around, or you know, in this case also effect due to the accretion disk, etc. For binary pulsars, you are in the strong field, but the velocity is still low. And so here is really strong, highly dynamic regime, as we are used to say. Now, I think many people have their favorite plot to contrast this kind of results. And I took one from the report of the third generation detectors. This is the curvature, which scales like the inverse of kilometer here. So for just one object, this will be the mass of the object, the size. And here you have the potential. And there are many, you know, dots here that represent the results from, you know, again, in the solar system, double pulsar, etc. And I want to highlight here the fact that if you are in a binary system, L will be the separation. So this can be also treated as the velocity in the binary, V square. And so if you go in this direction, you are high velocity. And here you can have ground-based detectors. This is in space, LISA. This is the experiment Gravity with observing flares around Sagittarius star. And the Event Horizon Telescope, actually Messier 87, the image is looking here because the curvature is smaller, because the black hole is larger in mass with respect to the one at the center of our galaxy. So this would be basically where the Event Horizon Telescope will be if our black hole at the center of our galaxy will be measured. Now, as you consider compact objects that are smaller in size, let's say for compact objects, their mass is smaller, the curvature is larger. That's why with ground-based detector, the curvature is going to be larger than for events that you will see with LISA, for example, except the extreme mass ratio binaries where you can have a small object. So LISA will arrive also in this area here. So now what I want to say is that if you have a body, two bodies in a bound motion, as I said, V square is this M over L, and the curvature, actually, it's basically the frequency of the binary. And you can, you know, compute it by putting numbers here. And so this means, again, if you have sources that merge in the kilohertz, the curvature, you're going to probe, you know, the curvature will be higher. And this is the case of neutron star, for example, or black holes with small mass. Now, another thing I wanted to say that will come back later is that the orbital period, as the two bodies go around each other, changes very rapidly, for example, by one order of magnitude from 30 Hz to 130 Hz. So the phase of the waveform changes very, very quickly. This is different from, for example, what you do with binary pulsar, where the variation in the orbital period, P dot, it's small, very small, but of course it's used to do tests of generativity, but if you were taking the second derivative of the orbital period, will be basically negligible for binary pulsar. So this is not the case for what LIGO and Virgo can see. Okay, so let me go now to the test. So I'm referring here to the most recent paper that the LIGO and Virgo collaboration have put on the archive last December. For in the second part of the third run, there were 14 new binary black hole, one neutron star black hole, but these results were also added in a cumulative way because you can add events so that your bounds become better to the number of binary black holes and binary neutron star that were observed previously. Now, you can see here, you don't have as a total number of events 90. And the reason is because these tests of general relativity are not done over the entire population, but only for the gravitational wave signals, which have a false alarm rate less than 10 to the minus 3 per year, just to be more confident on them. Take the signals that are stronger, and you are more confident that of their origin. Okay, now just to impress you, this is the table from the paper that illustrates all these events, the 14 plus the neutron star black hole. I don't pretend, you know, you are going to read here. These are just the main parameters, the mass, the distance, the signal to noise ratio you can see here. And now these are the tests performed. And these are all null tests, so theory agnostic tests. And one is assuming that basically general relativity is represented by a quasi-circular binary system. And then one is adding deviations. And these deviations, one assumes, are going to be small, okay? What are these tests? There is a residual test that we'll explain in a moment, consistency test that in spiral, the merger in down, they follow the kind of signal that you expect in general relativity, parameterized test of the generation of gravitational waves, test on the multiple structure around the compact objects during the in-spiral, dispersion relation modified in alternative theory of general relativity. For example, if you have a graviton, the mass, if the graviton has a mass, test of the remnant, whether the remnant is a Kerr black hole or something else, or neutron star, echoes that could be produced if you don't have an horizon or a surface that is only absorbing, and polarization. Now, for all these tests, the waveform models that are used are in the two families that I was describing last Friday, so IMR phenomenological one, and the effective one-body waveforms, so I'm not going to discuss them anymore today, but these are the waveforms that are going to be used, depending on the test. Okay, let me start from the residual test. This is important to, actually, it's an important test to understand whether our assumption that general relativity, if it's going to be violated, the violation is going to be small, it's important. So what is done, the question one is asking is, are the residuals, so the remnant coherent power, consistent with the noise in the detector? So one does a study in which one basically subtracts to the data the maximum likelihood GR template. So you do a vision analysis with a GR template. You look at the best fit. Then you subtract and you look basically at the residual. And this is done for each event 1 second around the trigger time of the event. And now you compute this residual, you look at the residual, you basically look at how much signal-to-noise ratio there is in the residual. And in fact, you compute the 90% credible upper limit on the distribution of the SNR on the whatever is left on the coherent SNR. And what you want is that this quantity has to be basically has to be not very different from, has to be consistent with the noise of the detector. And this is the plot of the residual SNR for the different events as a function of the SNR of the GR template that was used for that particular event. And what you have to get from this plot, the only thing I want to say is that there is absence of correlations between the 90% credible upper limit on the SNR that you compute from the residual and the SNR due to the GR template. And this basically allows you to conclude that, that the signals are consistent with the GR template. So it's a good assumption to assume that, you know, the GR template is doing it's a good assumptions for the signal. There could be, however, some small deviations. That is what we are after. So let me go now the first test I want to describe. This is called the Inspire Mergering Down Consistency Test. Was done from the very first paper of test of general relativity with the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, the first event, gravitational wave 150914. And in fact, what you do is that you basically try to understand whether there is consistency in the inspiral and post-inspiral part of the signal. Now, it's a bit arbitrary to decide where the post-inspiral starts. So what is done is that you take the mass and the spin of the remnant, and you compute the innermost stable circular orbit as your point of transition between inspiral and post-inspiral. And I just indicated it here for this particular example. Then you compute the final mass of the object that forms after merge from the parameters, the masses and the spin of the inspiral part. And you do the same just looking, just basically using the data up to this point. And then you do it from this point on. This will be the mass or the spin from the post-inspiral part. And then you compute these two quantities that if there is consistency have to be zero, otherwise there will be a violation. And for this test, you can imagine you have to have enough signal-to-noise ratio in the spiral and the merger, so you cannot use all the events. And also, you really have to have some, in spiral part that is non-negligible for this test. So you also have a bound on the total mass of the binary. And so only these events were used in this latest study by LIGO and Virgo. This is the signal-to-noise ratio. And the results is the following for these two quantities. Now, these are the posterior distribution that if they encompass zero, it means the test is good for general relativity. General relativity is here, zero. Then you can basically compute also the posterior distribution that are here in gray, combining the likelihood of all the events, assuming that if there is a deviation, this is going to be the same for all the events. And this is basically the result of the gray area. And by the way, the color here just means the total mass of the binary. So the color differs because, I mean, you can have, again, a test that depending on how much is the total mass, you are more having, for low total mass means you have more of the inspiral. Larger total mass means you have more of the mergering down. Now, this way of combining the events, it's too is not conservative because you are assuming that if there is a deviation from general relativity, that's the same for all the events. But that deviation may depend on the parameters of the binary. So a hierarchical combined method has been introduced since I think a year or not in the analysis of the LIGO and Virgo data. And so what you do here is that you don't assume that all the deviation parameters are going to be the same. The non-GR parameters, as I wrote here, are drawn from a common Gaussian distribution, which has a certain mean and the standard deviation. And the mean and the standard deviation are inferred from the data. So now when you do this test, you also basically include also these other two parameters. And these parameters are then inferred from the data. They have to, for GR, this parameter will be, you know, mu zero and sigma zero. So if you do that, so if you use now the hierarchical combined methods, and you also put together all the events cumulatively, so this is only the first catalog, the second catalog, the third catalog in a cumulative way, you can see that the posterior distribution, for example, for the mass of the remnant, becomes narrow as you should be the case because you are adding more events, and you can see here for the spin. And these are the bounds at 90% level. If you were using the hierarchical combined method, or if you were using the joining the posterior, which is less conservative. Okay, so now let me go to another test, which is done by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, which concerns is called parametrized test of the generation of gravitational waves. I was saying at the very beginning that you have we have this compact object going very fastly at the very end. The orbital period is changing, so we can probe the post-Newtonian parameters in the phase and also higher order parameters in the merger in down by decomposing the waveform in frequency domain, in an amplitude and in the phase. The amplitude is not very important here. We focus on the phase. And the phase in frequency domain, besides some irrelevant terms here, constant and linear in F, can be written as a post-Newtonian expansion. And these coefficients here are computed in general relativity. I will show you in a moment what they are. But you can add corrections, okay, here. And how do you get these coefficients? Well, on Friday, I was telling you that the phase of the gravitational waveform is computed from the binding energy, the luminosity, I wrote here at leading order, and then through the balance equation, you can compute the phase. And then you go in the frequency domain and you have it in the frequency domain. Now, I want to actually also highlight one thing, that these two quantities and their deviations, they mix the conservative and dissipative part. This is important to keep in mind when we do, for example, relate to other experiments that are also putting bounds on this positional parameter, because some of them are only looking at the conservative part of the dynamic, although binary pools are also the dissipative, as you will see in a moment later. Now, to be more quantitative, I want in full glory to show you what is this post-Newtonian phase in general relativity, computing in post-Newtonian. So I wrote here, SPA just means stationary phase approximation. This is for quasi-circular orbit. All the tests I'm going to describe are for quasi-circular orbit. So this term here is the leading order term, b to the minus phi. Nu is just the symmetric mass ratio. Then at minus 1 pn order, you start seeing here a term, which actually should not be there in GR. It's, for example, in Brunsdicke, in Jordan Fields Brunsdicke theory, this would give rise to dipolar radiation. This term at 1 pn, you have a genuine post-Newtonian general relativity term, which is this one, but you can have a term that is there if the graviton has a mass, which induces a 1 pn correction that depends on the Compton wavelength of the gravitational associated to the graviton, and also the distance of the binary to the source. We will come back to this later. At 1.5 positional order, you have spin orbit terms that are in this coefficient beta. At 2 pn, you have a spin-spin term that are in this coefficient sigma. And at 5 pn, you can have tidal effects. I alluded to them in the lectures of last week. They are there for neutron stars because lambda is different from zero in neutron stars. They depend on the equation of state of neutron star, on the radius of the neutron star, etc. Now, one important piece of information is that when you look at low post-Newtonian terms, the leading order, minus 1 pn, 1 pn, they dominate at low frequency, V here depends on the frequency. The high positronian terms are going to be important, as you can imagine, close to merger at high frequency. Now, I also wanted to show you the waveform, how it is modified when you add these deviation parameters I was alluding to. And I want to give you this example, here. So this is a signal like one of the signals that were discovered during the second run, the mass ratio 9. This was the binary with a puzzling companion. If you add 50% of violation at 1 p.m. and you align a parameterized waveform where you add this deviation with a non-parameterized waveform at 20 Hz, you start seeing, as you see, the deviation as you move at toward merger. However, with these methods, when we add one parameter and then we look for it with the data, we go back to to the waveform in general relativity. We apply this only to the inspiral. And so if I take now this and I align the two waveforms at merger, they are going to be the same. So the last part is the same, but we are looking at this region of the inspiral where we are adding this extra parameter. So what are the results? Okay, so we add this extra parameter at each post-Newtonian order, each time varying the post-Newtonian order, and we do a Bayesian analysis together with all the other 15 parameters on which the binary depends. And then we plot here the posterior distribution after marginalizing on all the other parameters for example, the minus 1 pn, the 0 pn, et cetera, et cetera. And for the phenomenological model, we can have also parameters that describe the merger in down that are tuned to numerical relativity, but then they can be, you can add a deviation to them. And the different colors, okay, correspond to the different models because we want to understand the systematics. That's why we use different models. And whether it's empty or full, it's where you use, join the different events, combining the likelihood, just multiply the likelihood, or you use this other method of the hierarchical combined method. So all the posteriors here, this is the second catalog, encompass zero. So this means GR is not violated. So then you can term it in a bound on these parameters. And I want to highlight, first of all, the scalar, dipole emission. The minus 1 pm, this is a test of the strong equivalence principle. This is for the binary black holes, and you can look here at the binary neutron star. We'll come back to this in a few slides because this is important. And these are the different post-Newtonian parameters. And you can see the single event, and then with the triangle when you combine the events all together. And the color here represents again the total mass or the shear mass of the binary. So red means you are having systems that are more massive, and not surprisingly, you can put constraints on more on the mergering down parameters. And when you have more access to the inspiral, you can put constraints on the post-Newtonian parameters. Now, this was the second catalog, and I should say, I forgot, I wrote here, you can also use these results to put some constraint on a specific theory of gravity, alternative to general relativity. And I will have actually a slide in a moment also about that. But let's go to the most recent catalogs. Now you can add the 15 events that were discovered during last 6 months of the third run. And these are again the posterior distributions. And when you put now these results together, again, if you use the hierarchically combined methods, you will get a posteriors on the mean and the deviation, the standard deviation parameter of the underlying distribution, because this is the method, as I said, in which you don't assume that deviation parameter is the same for all the events. And the results you get by using this hierarchical method is now the following. So this is, again, adding all the events, including the second catalog up to the third for the post-Newtonian parameters. And I want to highlight this point here for the dipole emission. which is a factor two better than the previous results due to the neutron-star black hole. So the neutron-star black hole, it's a very, has many, many cycles because of the mass ratio. And so you have a stronger test of the minus 1 PM term. And again, here is the binary neutron star, and these are all the binary black holes. And you can see between the second and third catalog, there is not a lot of difference. Okay, so now I want to say something. I forgot I also had this comment. So one thing to keep in mind is that all these tests assume that you have a small deviation from general relativity. Now, there are some theory alternative to general relativity that predict some non-perturbative effect close to merger, like, for example, dynamical scalarization. And for this case, this test cannot be used, also for binary black holes. This is just a comment. Now, let's look more at the binary neutron star. The binary neutron star was a very long signal. So that's why we could put the most stringent test, especially at low frequency for the dipole emission. So these were the violin plots for that event. And this is the flux. This would be the deviation if you have dipole, determine if you have dipole emission. And so the bound with LIGO and Virgo was of the order of 10 to the minus 5, which is also represented in this plot here. Now, if you take the binary pulsars, the binary pulsars are very sensitive to the dissipation, dissipative effects. And the bound is a few order of magnitude better than what you can do with LIGO and Virgo. Moreover, again, the question, what I was saying before, this test also for binary neutron star, one has to take also, be careful if there are no perturbative effects that would not be there at low frequency, that could not be captured actually with this method, because this method assumes that you have a small deviation from general relativity. Now, if you want to term this bound, this is a test theory agnostic, okay? I didn't specify any theory of general relativity. Now, if you want to turn it in a bound for a theory specific, I want to take one example, which is Jordan Fields Brunsdicker, that I guess many of you are familiar. This has quite a constraint, I would say. So I brought here the Einstein, the action in the Einstein frame. There is the Brunsdicker parameter, which you can also trade in terms of another parameter that is called alpha naught. And what you can do is that you can use that event, the binary neutron star, to constrain now omega Brunsdicker or alpha naught. But now it comes an important point that if you use the add just a deviation parameter, as I explained until now, and you do just a theory agnostic, and you have a prior which is uniform on this deviation parameter, you get a certain result. But if you are specifying from the beginning the specific theory of general relativity that you want to test, then you could sample directly on, let's say, alpha naught, and have a prior uniform on this parameter. And unfortunately, because the signal-to-noise ratio is not very large for these sources, we are still dominated by the prior in doing this calculation. So just because I want to briefly about this. So in this theory, the phi minus 2 coefficient in the phase is proportional to the difference between the scalar charge of the two neutron stars. So you have to do an analysis in which you have to take into account also the equation of state of the neutron star, the mass, because the scalar charge depends on them. And once you do that, this was done by Noah Sennett in this paper in preparation, you have the Poisson distribution for the parameter alpha naught in the case in which you do this theory agnostic or theory specific. And there are some differences which are smaller than the differences due to, for example, the equation of state that you have used. And just roughly, this is the bound that one can put. And now when you compare with binary pulsar, you have a few order of magnitude, better with binary pulsar. And in fact, I remind you with Cassini, the omega Brunsdicker that corresponds to this value, which actually now binary pulsar even better than this, is of the order of 40,000. So of course, it's the first time that this can be done, you know, with the gravitational waves in the highly dynamical regime. But, you know, this gives you an idea also for this particular test of the dipole emission, how these results compare with what is available today with other experiments. However, with gravitational waves, we can do better. You will see in a moment. So here, I cannot resist in showing you the results with the binary pulsar that were actually just came out last December. This was observed for 16 years now. And in the plot, in the paper, they have an interesting plot where they show exactly this deviation parameter I was showing you before as a function of the post-Newtonian order. And this is the most recent result. By the way, this is not the dipole emission, but the leading order effect, the quadruple radiation. And you can see that the double pulsar does better than the neutron star and the binary black hole in LIGO. But why it does better? Because, I mean, people have observed this system for 16 years, and the system made almost 60,000 orbital cycles. So this corresponds to, you know, many, many cycles. So it's they have a better accuracy, of course. Now, I want to say that, however, okay, 0.5 PN is not there in general relativity. So also that is quite interesting that binary pulsar can do comparable with LIGO. But as you go beyond 0.5 PN, you can see that the double pulsar cannot achieve the measurement that we can do on with gravitational waves observation on the ground or even in space. And the reason is because the velocity of the double pulsar is still much lower than what you can have with gravitational waves with LIGO and Virgo, which are probing you know, the two objects just at the very end, where the velocity becomes close to the speed of light. I should have had now this slide before, sorry. I wanted to, however, tell you that the polar radiation or even the quadrupole leading order, if we consider the future and how well we can do, you know, in the future with the next generation of LIGO detectors, just improve sensitivity, but also Cosmic Explorer, Einstein telescope, or even LISA, depending on the binary black hole, binary neutron star, the type of source, you can see that we can constrain, for example, the dipole emission quite well. And even better if we do this multi-band gravitational wave astronomy, where we see the event first in LISA and then on detectors on the ground. And there is a quite comprehensive study that has been done recently to see how the post-Newtonian bounds will evolve, just a projection, with the future detectors on the ground and in space. Okay, so now let me change a moment topic. You can also test the presence of, you can test whether the quadruple moment of the compact objects in the binary is the one predicted by general relativity for Kerr black holes. So the spin-induced quadruple moment, as I wrote here, measures the degree of oblateness of the object, which is due to the spin. And this quantity is imprinted, is one of the terms in the post-Newtonian expansion, basically, is imprinted in the gravitational waveform. Schematically, this spin-induced quadruple moment can be written in the following way. Depends on the spin square and the mass cube. And the coefficient kappa is 1 for Kerr black holes, but can range between 2 and 14 for neutron stars, 10-150 for rotating boson stars, can be even negative for grava stars. So now you can do this test with the data of LIGO. LIGO and Virgo have done this test. Now, the only parameter, so in a binary, you have 2 kappa, no? Depending, 1 for each compact object. In this analysis, it was assumed that the deviation from the GR value are equal for the two bodies. So only one parameter was varied, which is this combination. And this is the result of the posterior distribution for the events. And this is the result when you put together all the events of all the events until now, also of the previous catalog. And again, if you use the hierarchically combined in blue, and joining, multiplying just the likelihood in red. And this is the value obtained from the hierarchical combined analysis. So it starts to become, you know, interesting. I mean, you can see, I mean, the error is still quite large, I should say. Now, this is one test, and in the future, you can probe that the objects are not, you know, the Kerr-Black hole in general relativity by looking at other things, at the tidal deformability, which is zero for black holes in GR, maybe not zero in alternative theory, tidal heating. The black holes can absorb gravitational waves. This is called tidal heating. So with future detector, future runs with higher signal-to-noise ratio, this also can be, you know, probed. And in the future, if we think about LISA, this measurement will be just exquisite. And I want to show you one plot. Forget about these three plots here, because now I don't have the time to explain. The quadruple moment, the deviation from the quadruple moment that you can get with LISA using the so-called extreme acceleration spirals with different populations for the emeries and also different models for the emery, it will be of the order of 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 3. So this will be really amazing. We will be able to map the space-time, the multiple structure of the space-time around the compact object with really very high precision. So now let me go to another important test that was done by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, which concerns now the remnant, the object that forms after merger. Now, in general relativity, two black holes merge, should be the final object should be a Kerr black hole, and should be characterized the gravitational waves by quasi-normal modes. And if we believe in NOAIR conjecture, then the frequency decay time for an astrophysical black hole depends only on the mass and the spin. So to disprove this conjecture, you can observe more than one quasi-normal mode, compute the mass and the spin, and see whether they are consistent with each other. Now, this is not yet possible because we don't have events which have such a large signal-to-noise ratio in the merger ring down to be able to extract more than one quasi-normal mode. But some work can be done for the dominant mode. So there are two methods. One uses a superposition of damped sinusoids. So I have an equation here to show you that the polarization during the ring down can be decomposed in modes, in spheroidal, decomposed in spheroidal harmonics. So you have here a damped part that this is tau, okay? That depends on the L and M and also the overtone. And then you have the frequency of the mode that also depend on L, M, and N. So one test that was done was the hypothesis was to assume that the dominant mode, the frequency and decay time were the values of GR, but the first overtone was basically a deviation from GR with some deviation coefficient that you can see here. So this test was done with the analysis called Pyring, and this is the result. If you consider only the second catalog and then cumulative the third catalog for this deviation of the first overtone, zero again is GR. And you can see the bound with the hierarchical method actually. The decay time is not very informative from this analysis. Now, the other method that is used by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration was actually something that we developed here. So we use not the superposition of quasi-normal mode, but we parameterize an inspiral mergering down waveform model, where now the frequency and the decay time depends also on deviation parameter. So we have the full waveform. For example, an example here, if you change by 10% the frequency decay time, you see, you know, the difference between the parameterized and the GR value. So you can do it, again, you can use this model against the data. And these are the results for the fractional variation of the frequency and the decay time for many events that you cannot see here. This is emphasizing two events, 150914, the very first one. And an event which was very interesting, was very similar to the first one ever detected, but had even a larger signal-to-noise ratio. And in fact, it gives the best bound on the dominant frequency and decay time of deviation parameter until now, actually. And the gray are just obtained, you know, putting together all the events. And these are basically the bounds that we obtain with this analysis. Now, I will skip a moment this. So one thing I wanted to say is that now, okay, so you have a measurement of the deviation of the dominant quasi-normal mode. What can you do with that, okay? How can you turn in some specific theory of general relativity? That's not so easy. I want to give you just one example, however, what can you extract from it? In this paper, people have tried to describe, to extract basically the quasi-normal mode in, for a dark object in which you replace the horizon with a membrane with some, you know, physical properties, including viscosity. And they use Birkhoff theorem outside the black hole. So this is just non-spinning. And they computed the equation for the perturbation and extracted the axial and polar quasi-normal modes from it that depends now on the viscosity and the deviation from the horizon epsilon. Now you can take these bounds on the deviation parameters. Okay, you assume, I mean, this is a bit qualitative, but give an idea of what you actually can do for the axial perturbations. You assume that you can basically measure the deviation at the level of 10-15%. So for the real part of omega, as a function of the viscosity and the deviation from the horizon, they excluded some region, which are here and here. And then you add for the imaginary part, the constraint that come from the measurement, and you end up at the end with only this region that is not ruled out. And this is the region close to the viscosity of a black hole, actually, which is 1 over 16 pi. And basically tells you that epsilon, so that you're measuring, you're putting a constraint on the compactness at the level of 10%. Now, it will be very interesting to extend this result to the spinning case, because this result, this analysis, together with many others in the literature, suffer from one problem. When you try to go back to understand, you know, what does it mean in terms of a specific theory of general relativity, is that unfortunately, in an alternative theory of general relativity that we know today, people have not been able to compute the quasi-normal modes for spinning objects. Because in the spinning case, you cannot, at least it's very difficult to disentangle the angular part from the radial part, as Tsiolkovsky did in the case of gravity, in the case of general relativity. There have been studies in the small spin approximation, but in the full case, this is not available. And this is important because if you want to turn these bounds on, again, some theory specific, you need to have, you need to know what are the quasi-normal modes in the case in which you have rotation, because the final object that forms after merge is supposed to be spinning, actually. Okay, so now I wanted just to touch on a couple of other things. I think I have two slides, if I remember correctly. So one another important analysis that was done by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, which is also related with what I was just saying, it's in order to probe the object that form after merge, you can look for signature of the presence of not an horizon, but a kind of surface which can also be reflected, which is somewhere displaced with respect to the horizon. And this is just a picture taken from this paper. When you have a surface that can be also reflected, not just absorbing, like for a black hole in care, then you can have modes that are trapped in this region here, and they go back and forth, and then they can come out from the potential. I described this potential on Friday, actually, in form of echoes. And so there was an analysis done by the LIGO Virgo collaboration looking for these echoes. These echoes are characterized by some parameters, you know, the amplitude of the echo, when start the first echo after merge, the periodicity of the echoes, etc. And a morphology-independent approach was used. using the train of decaying sine Gaussian as wavelets with some parameters, which are basically the parameter I illustrated here in this plot, and no statistical significant evidence for echo was found. Okay, so before I conclude, tests of gravitational wave propagation have been done. I alluded to this one, I think on Friday, or maybe even the first lecture. I want to talk about another test that is done by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, which is looking at modification of the dispersal relation. In general relativity, gravitational waves are non-dispersed, dispersive, in the sense that they satisfy this relation. Now, you can add a term. This was suggested many years ago by Cliff Will, which will be there, for example, if you have a massive gravity theory or theory that violates Lorentz invariance. And then I told you at some point that, in the middle of my talk that if you have, for example, a massive gravity theory, you can have a modification of the phase. So massive gravity here will be alpha equal to zero, basically. In this case, yes, I'm done. The mass is related to this parameter, okay? If you put alpha equal to zero. And this turns out to be a new parameter in the phase at 1 p.m. post-Newtonian order. This is what I mentioned some slides ago. And now you can do a Bayesian analysis again, adding this parameter. Actually, you can do for each value of alpha. And just one second. And this is the result of the posterior distributions. I focus here only on alpha equal to zero, but you can have also for different value of alpha. These are the violin plots again that encompass zero, which is the value of GR. And then you can turn it in a bound. And again, just looking at alpha equal to zero, this is the improvement of the bound, which is the bound of the mass of the graviton, which improved by a factor 1.4. With respect to the previous catalog, and is 2.5 better than the bound on the fifth fourth from the solar system. So this is good. So I skip this slide, you can ask, and I want to go to the end because it's time. Try to explain that gravitational waves are pristine astronomical messengers, which is very important to do this test of general relativity or gravity, although there is some contamination also astrophysically. I alluded last week also gravitational lensing. So LIGO and Virgo have already started to probe the strong field gravity and highly dynamical regime, setting interesting bounds in so far unexplored territory. I want to stress the fact that the nature of the compact objects, the multiple moments, the presence of a photon orbit or light ring, the horizon, etc., all this information is imprinted in the waveform, not just in the remnant, you know. It's in each merger, in spiral, merger, in down, you can find signature of this effect, of what these quantities are. Now, until now, the LIGO and Virgo collaboration has done a variety of theory agnostic tests. For inspire merger in the waveform, it will be important to do theory specific tests, but for that, we need to basically redo all the work I mentioned to you last Friday to build the waveform model inspire merger in alternative theory of general relativity. And this is not trivial. Some of these theories also don't have a well post initial value problem. So they have to be tackled as an effective field theory, et cetera. But we need to do that, going more into the future. And finally, the future is very bright. And finally, I want to also to say that it's quite interesting also to connect the different experiments that are happening right now, even more into the future, including binary pulsar gravity, the event horizon telescope. So again, I want to thank my group and the work was also represented in this presentation. And again, the LIGO material that I showed is also based and supported by NSF and by other agency and also on the side of the Virgo European Gravitational Observatory, et cetera. And so all my colleagues of the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. Thank you very much. And I stop here. Sorry to take a few more minutes. I think I went a bit over.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alessandra. Thanks for this inspiring set of lectures. Any question here from the audience?
Hi, I have two unrelated questions. So since you mentioned effective field theory, I was wondering about the leading term in the effective field theory as to whether gravitational waves can tell us about the value of the cosmological constant to any degree of precision now or in the future.
About the cosmological constant, so I think in my first lecture I showed that binary systems are standard sirens, so you can do a cosmology with them. You can, for example, actually there was a measurement of the Hubble parameter with the coincident event of the gravitational wave 17.017, the binary neutron-star. Now, because that event was at 40 megaparsec, the only quantity that you can measure there is the Hubble parameter. But in the future, we are going to see events at much larger redshift. So if you start going to large redshift, then you can probe with a gravitational wave, not just the Hubble parameter, you can probe omega matter, omega lambda, etc. So this will be possible in the future. I think mainly with LISA and gravitational wave detectors of third generation on the ground. So let's say starting from the next decade. So yeah, that's possible, but not right now.
And my second question is whether we can observe some super radiance with the present or future gravitational wave detectors.
Do you want to know what? How can we measure super radiance?
And whether we can do it at all with the gravitational wave detectors.
Actually, that's something that I didn't discuss at all in these three lectures, and even today, which was maybe also a bit overlapping. So you might know that people, actually starting from work of Minar Vanitaki, has been pointed out that if you have very low light, ultralight particles having mass in 10 to the minus 15, 16 electron volt, this particle, if they exist, they could form, because of super radiance phenomena, they could form bosons clouds around black holes. And these clouds because the cloud rotate, and they could produce gravitational waves like monochromatic signals. So they are a bit like the continuous waves from neutron stars, isolated neutron stars, but now this is different. These are black holes which have clouds of this formed by these ultralight particles. And so people have looked at the projection for seeing these signals, either as single events or forming the stochastic background, like an astrophysical background. And there are papers in the literature. Again, you can, even today, you can put some bounds. Actually, I should say also the LIGO and Virgo collaboration has put some bounds. This is possible. This could be maybe not so direct, but it's a phenomenon that is a consequence of super radiance.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Now, I should have actually mentioned that today, but there was already a lot of material.
Actually, if there are no questions, there is a question there. So let's start with that.
Hello, Alessandro. I am Nips.
Can you keep your microphone closer? Is it?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm Gibbs from QLS. Okay, you talk a lot about the to improve the performance of the detector. I wish to know if machine learning could play a role on this process.
Yes. I think machine learning, of course, is a technique that now several people working in this field are actually employing. Until now has not been used, for our for LIGO Virgo detections or parameter estimations, but people have applied for some particular cases, binary with a certain mass and spin, etc. Because the fact is that you have to also train. So first of all, you have to train your method. So for that, you have to use the waveforms. So the waveforms still have to be produced and they have to be accurate, because otherwise. So the answer to you is that there are many examples now of groups that are starting to use these techniques. They have not, as I said, being adopted by the LIGO and Virgo collaboration, but I think it's very good to take the best also of these methods and try to, combine with the way in which we have done this until now, which use much filtering.
I have another question, which is I don't know if the detection of gravitational wave could tell us something about string theory.
Good question.
This is mine.
So I can turn it in a. So what prediction from string theory we want to test? Okay. I think there are people who are proposing that in order to resolve or try to understand the so-called black hole paradox information problem, you could have modifications at the level of the horizon of a black hole, which is quite macroscopic actually, because you would expect that generally the deviation from string theory come from the Planck scale, which is maybe inside a black hole close to the singularity. But there are some examples. These are not theories, I would say, are more models where one trying to modify in order to address the problem of the black hole information paradox, maybe you don't have anymore an horizon, etc. And people have used that to motivate the kind of work I was showing, where you put a surface which is reflective. So there could be a link there, but I think we need to have more a connection between the prediction of string theory and, really something that we can probe in a quantitative way where it's not just a model. We can have a different some comments from you, maybe. I'm talking with our host.
Atisha, you raise your hand to ask a question, or
maybe this was the question.
No, this was not the question. No, I think it would be one. I mean, okay. So thanks a lot, first of all, Alessandra, for a really wonderful talk. And I had a question. I think it would be great if you could use it for testing string theory, but I think some of these corrections are more in quantum regime. So I'm not sure if it will actually be possible to test them. I had a sort of technical question and one more general question. So one thing I wanted to ask is that this effective one body formalism which you developed seems to be in some ways considering how nonlinear the system is, it's a bit of a surprise why it works so well. So I mean, can you comment upon that?
That's a tough question. It's the question of where are the nonlinearities, okay? Uh-huh. And first of all, I mean, I would say the following: the higher order post-Newtonian terms are important toward the end. So it's not that if you were using just one post-Newtonian order, or even not one, the leading order, you will not get a very good accuracy. So the high post-Newtonian terms are important. However, what's happening is that the solution of the signal close to the merger, as you go to the merger, which is an attractor, is not wild, is not complex. It's like that the dissipation is so strong at the very end that you basically very quickly you know, have the two bodies just merging with each other. And also there is a kind of redshift effect because you know, from the observer at infinity, as if you think about, you are observer at infinity and you have the body that goes around and then merges into the black hole. The gravitational wave frequency associated to the orbital motion is actually redshifted from the from the point of view of the observer at infinity. And so, you know, I mean, yeah, it's not a high frequency stage or, and also the dissipation, very quickly, you dissipate the quasi-normal mode, the space-time vibrate. And so the transition between the phase in which you get the radiation from the object going around, and then when it merge and, you know, you form the final object, is so quick, so dissipative, that, yeah, you are not seeing any wildness or chaoticity or, you know, but the nonlinearities are there. I mean, in the sense you do need higher order corrections, yes, in positionality. I don't know if I answer your question, because this is—
Thank you. I also had one more general question about the prospects. I mean, since there are young people in the audience, like Lisa and this Tian Chen, I mean, they are supposed to come online like 2030 or something. I mean, do you know, can you say something about the prospects of it? I mean, where do they stand, how they are in terms of—
I had something at the end of my first lecture, but I can say again, so first of all, there are two important things. So the space, going to space with LISA, and well, the Chinese would like to have also at the same time, even two detectors, but we don't know, you know, if that will really happen. But for LISA, this is a mission that is you know, funded and will take place. I think the launch is 2036 at the moment. It's a big it's a mission from ESA with a big participation from NASA, and it is going to see sources that are complementary to what LIGO and Virgo and Kagra can see. These are supermassive black holes at the center of the galaxy merging. I mentioned the extreme aspatial binaries, small object around the very big black hole, white dwarf in our galaxy, etc. So it's very rich, the scientific case. And then the facilities, the next facilities on the ground, not yet funded, but there is Cosmic Explorer in the US and Einstein Telescope in Europe. Still, the site is not decided whether it will be, you know, in Italy or in the Netherlands, or in some other place in Germany. So, and these are detectors on the ground, but the new facility, Einstein Telescope, is underground and is going to see basically black holes up to when the first star forms, up to redshift 10. If they are already there, we are going to see them. So this is also very interesting, is broadening the bandwidth, going more at low frequency up to 1 Hz. I also mentioned in my first lecture, I mean, for the young people here, even Voyage 2050 program of ESA for the period 2035-2050 could be also very good for gravitational waves, because they selected a team where gravitational waves could be part of. It's not yet decided, but so, I mean, for young people, the future is very bright. So it's a new field, and it will last for centuries, actually.
Okay, so I think we can conclude, and let's thank Alessandra once again.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much, actually, to you for inviting me here, and so sorry that I could not be there. It will be a very different experience.
Okay, now, so before we, so Alessandra,
I leave the floor to Atish for an announcement.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Thanks. No, so first of all, I want to say, I really want to thank Alessandra for agreeing to give these lectures, even if remotely, and really very clear and wonderfully organized lectures. It's really an exciting field, and I'm actually happy to announce also that on 9th of February, we'll have Virgo and Ego coming and giving a joint colloquium at ICTP. So we are really into gravitational wave excitement. Professor Stavros Katsanevas, who's the director of Ego, and Professor Giancarlo Cella, the data analysis coordinator of Virgo, they will come together and give a joint colloquium. So Alessandra, you're also invited. I'm sure you have, you know about it, but we will send you an invitation in any case. I think it fits very well with your talk. So let's thank Alessandra one more. And then I have another announcement to make once again.
Thank you again. Thank you very much.